But we can rest assured that even if we don't see the manifestation of the answer to our prayers, that our prayers have been heard, and that that answer is on the way. As we see here, the angel of the Lord, the Son of Man, appeared and said, "The Prince of Persia delayed me." What can delay your prayers? Well, here the Prince of Persia is also referred to or known as Satan, the Antichrist, demonic spirits. Even other things can hinder our prayers, such as wrong attitudes, wrong, not having the right heart. In other words, the motive for your prayers. I think I've used the example before that, you know, if you pray, "Lord, help me steal from the 7-Eleven, that's probably not going to happen, right? Because we know that it's not in accordance with his will. It is not a right motive. But if we're praying in accordance with his will, if we're praying with right motives, with a pure heart, in spirit and in truth, the Lord is always faithful to hear and answer our prayers. If we have, as the scripture says, an ought with your brother, in other words, if you're angry, if you're holding an offense, a grudge, harboring some hatred. Remember, we read some time ago that if you're having any of those things, the scripture says, leave your sacrifices and your donations or your offerings at the altar. Go and make amends with the person that you have a problem with, and then come back and pray. So we know that misappropriated anger and so forth, hatred, grudges, jealousies, envyings, coveting can hinder our prayer. In fact, the word of God is so important, places such emphasis on this, because when it says that even the prayers of a husband or the prayers of the wife can be hindered. That's right. Can be hindered if we are not in right relationship with one another. If we are not both yielding to and being yielded of one another. Another way to put that is submitting one to another. One to another. Men, not just wives submitting to husbands, but husband submitting to wives in accordance to his knowledge of her. And so if you're not in right relationship with your spouse, your prayers can be hindered. That's found, I think, in Peter. First Peter, I believe it is. So we want to realize that there are things that can hinder, delay the answer coming. But that does not mean that the answer has not already been determine. It's a very crucial point to understand in that in Daniel 10. So I'd like to just give a overview of where we have been. That we started out, of course, by reading, we have been studying Revelation, eschatology. Yeah, you've been involved in that, you know, the end time matters. Prophecies of Revelation. And I want you to kind of think too that, remember that John is also the disciple, the apostle, that Jesus said he loved. So here we have John, who had this wonderful, close relationship with Jesus when he first was on earth, in his earthly ministry, now receiving a revelation of Jesus the Christ. Isn't that amazing? He spent all that closeness developing a relationship with Jesus, And now some 30, 40 years later, he is receiving this revelation of Jesus. And it's like, why does he go to John, right? Doesn't John already know everything about Jesus? No, because the relationship between John and our Lord was so valued that Jesus came and revealed more to him. And that should also give us another little tidbit, you know, about prayers answered and also about a relationship with our Lord and Savior. It is important that if we want to have ever-increasing knowledge about the Lord, about our Father and His ways, if we want ever-increasing understanding, more wisdom, more discernment, it is crucial that we have a relationship. You know how hard it is to ask someone something of whom you don't know, you don't have a relationship with? Now, in some manners, some places, it might be easy. You know, you're standing in the grocery store line, you're short a dime or something, you might turn to the person and say, hey, you know, you have a dime? And that may be okay. But I'm talking about something, you know, a particular issue that's going on with you. You know, if you don't have a relationship, it's hard to go to someone and ask for that very important, that dire, that crucial help, or that crucial information, or even a very intimate prayer. Usually you want to go to someone that you've had a relationship with, that you've developed a relationship with, you spent some time knowing them and they know you, so that when they give you that answer, they're not giving it to you off the cuff. They're not giving it to you as a stranger, but they're giving it to you knowing what you may truly need. And here we have John remembering. Now, John is on where? The Isle of Patmos. He has been put there as a prisoner. This was no vacation. Remembering, he was put there because he had been preaching and teaching the word of God, and they warned him, don't do it anymore. And so, boom, you're on this island, the Isle of Patmos, as your punishment. And that should also back up something that we said a few weeks ago. Christians, true followers of the Christ, of the word of God, will suffer some persecution, will suffer some disease, some suffering, some danger, some pestilences, because the Lord said that we will have tribulation in our lives. And we discussed a week ago that tribulation is just that: suffering, disease, disasters, even persecution, martyrdom. So, very important to think about who is this John, what was his relationship, and why would our Lord come to him? But he's praying there. Remember, he was sent there because he was teaching and preaching, right? And what is his response? To go into exile to this island and to continue praying and seeking the Lord. So he obviously was praying and seeking the Lord. And then this revelation of Jesus the Christ is forthcoming. And the angel of the Lord is revealing to him from the first book to the end, what is the true Lamb of God, his power and his glory. And he starts off, as you remember, with a description. Right, he's talking about how God appears, gold and bronze, fiery eyes, and he describes the throne of God and all the angels that are in the heavenly hosts and all of the priests, the 24 elders that are worshiping and praying, and everybody giving glory to God. And he's continually to describe all these lampstands and the golden light and the sun, the light shone so brightly from our Lord, his glory, that there had no need of the sun or the moon and the stars. And we see this heavenly scene of all God's hosts and all the important figures that are functioning in this revelation, this period of time that is being explained of how the end is coming. The entire recapping, if you will, of all of the important aspects of the Bible from Genesis to the end, to Jude. And we see in some ways a creation where it's paralleled with the 7 days of creation. The one day is 1,000 years, and every day of each day of the creation story, we see a parallel in the sevens that are prevalent throughout the book of Revelation. We talked about the spiritual numbers and holy numbers very important numbers, continuing the repetition that we see throughout the Bible. And it really comes in true large form in the book of Revelation. And we began talking about, we looked into the seven seals, and the first seal being opened was the white horse that had a bow and a crown, conquering. He came to conquer and conquering. Conquering and conquering whom? What? Have you ever thought about that? And then there was the red horse, the second seal, who had the power to remove peace, had a sword that they should cause people to kill one another. The black horse, the third seal, who had balances in his hands, who talked about the famine and the high cost of wheat and barley. And he also talked about how we wouldn't, you know, things would be so costly, there'd be such a famine that you'd be paying, $100 for a loaf of bread, and perhaps in our day. And he also gave a very stern piece of information. He said, do not hurt the oil and the wine. So there was a famine, right? But there was specific instruction, because remember that nothing can happen without God. Nothing can happen without God. God is in control of all. God controlled the hand of Satan when Satan requested of Job, just as God controls the hand of Satan when Satan requests of each of us. Satan has to have permission. He can only go so far. And here we see that same thing. And then the fourth seal, the pale or green horse, as some people say, even gray, the pale horse, the horse of death and hell, with the power to kill a fourth of the earth. Starvation, death, and the beast of death caused by the beast of the earth. And then we see the sixth seal, martyrs under the throne of the altar of God, given their white robes, so many that they couldn't be numbered. And they were told to rest for a little while. Yes, we know you want to know, when will you be avenged? When will your lives be come into full meaning? When will the enemy suffer for all that it has done? When? That means that it will happen, right? And in this sixth seal, the fifth seal, excuse me, we were told that rest a little while, wait a little while until the rest of the martyrs can join you. Because remember, God's work is not done. So this indicates to me, at the fifth seal, there are still Christians functioning in the world. Because he said, wait and for the rest of your martyrs to join you. So there were some saints already at the throne of God, under the altar of God, the martyrs, who were asking to be avenged. And he said, wait, because there's more martyrs to come. In other words, wait until the fulfillment has occurred and the kingdom of God reigns. Wait a little while, and in a little season, perhaps it was 4 months. And then the sixth seal, the wrath of the Lamb.